Ask not what we all be can do for you. Ask what you can do for we all be.
Sister Ruby L. Johnson, it's an honor to have you with us. I'd just like to ask you, what is the significance of this event that took place with the historical marker at the Cotton Gin Restaurant in Liberty, Mississippi?
The historical event was in memory of my father, Herbert Lee, for his contribution to the civil rights movement and being instrumental in helping to establish carrying African Americans to register the vote in 1961.
That's amazing. Actually, what happened at this particular location for them to honor him with a historical marker?
At this particular location on September 25th, 1961, my father was murdered. He was shot by a local state representative, E.A. Church.
Wow, that's amazing. Why was he shot? What was the reason behind him getting shot?
Well, the papers said, you know, different stories, and but we knew back in that time that blacks were supposed to be silent, even though if you were able to be successful as far as having property or home, it wasn't supposed to go any further than that. The vote gave you a voice. It went beyond than you're just having, being able to take care of your family, being able to be successful as a farmer. And Daddy was that. He could do those things. But the vote, he knew, was something that went so far beyond. It would give him a voice to do even more, and not only him, a voice to his children and others who came on after him. So that was his reason for working with Bob Moses when he came to Mississippi in the early 60s to establish the voter registry drive to get blacks to go to the polls to vote.
Now, your father, he was like...
I mean, to register, I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. Your father was the patriarch of the family. He had 9 children, correct?
Yes, he did. It was 9 of us alive at the time. My older sister is married away from home, Wilma Dean. Irma was in college at Southern at the time. And Roy, I think, was coming up. He was a senior in high school, or he had just graduated from high school, and the rest of us were at home. I was 9 at the time, and my youngest sister was 6. So she barely remembered Dad, and I could see the look on her face today, and I just felt so much empathy for her, because while we knew so much about Dad, even me as a 9-year-old, and she would often say to me, she said, "Ruby, I barely remember Daddy. I remember so little about him." You know, and I could see that today, you know, when she would hear the things being said about him.
Oh, wow. Do you remember what you was doing when you heard the news about your father being killed?
Actually, it's funny you should ask me that, because I shared that today. I didn't go to school that day. I wasn't feeling well. And I thought, oh, Daddy's going to kill me. He's going to have a fit. He's going to wonder why I'm missing school, because that's just something you didn't. He deemed what it was necessary for you to miss school. And it had to be because the crops needed to come in. It was something very, very important. But if you missed a day, you had to really, really work hard, because you couldn't miss 2 days in a row. So this particular day, I wasn't feeling well, and I had hid in the kitchen against the refrigerator, because I knew he was going to the cotton gin. He had gotten up early. He had gotten the truck loaded with the cotton, had on his little brown hat and his coveralls, and he said, "Red, what are you doing here?" And I said, "Dad, I'm not feeling well. I'm staying on." He said, "Well, okay then, and I'll see you later." And he left. And the next thing I knew, I don't know, it was like as soon as he left, where there's like a driveway into our house. It's almost like a little sink. I just saw this truck just like, bam, just went over right on up in front of the house, but there was no daddy. And I thought, well, what could have happened to daddy? Where's daddy? And our first cousin jumped out, and he was calling, hey, Prince, hey, Prince. And I could see mother running across the field, just running. And, you know, I heard them say daddy was dead, daddy had been killed. But it just, it made no sense because you're thinking, okay, was it an accident? But here's the truck. What could have happened? So we really didn't know that he had been shot and by whom. At least I did until late that evening. It was dark, and I heard some of our neighbors in our backyard talking. And that was just like a cold chill, a shock for me. Here's a man that lived in our community, had followed daddy along the way to the cottage, knowing that daddy was going to go there. You know, the question was, why didn't he kill him along the road, you know? Why did he go to the cottage? But he did. He followed him to the cottage. And my understanding, when dad got out of the truck, he had his gun pulled, and daddy said, wait, please don't kill me, and threw his hands up, and he shot him. That was what I was told. That's what we were told.
Did you understand the nature of his work at 9 years old when he got killed? Did you understand the danger of what he was doing in terms of his activism?
Oh, did we? Yes. I honestly did. You know why? Mm. It's because he was always so, he was so focused, the wisdom. He had a clear path, a direction as to the things he needed to do in life. It was his family, and he took care of us wonderfully. It was his community. I remember being, I don't know, we were at, I don't know, it was a school board, you know, where their parents would go to the little meetings mm-hmm. they would have at the schoolhouse, and how he wanted books for us. And he would say, well, my kids got to have these more regulatory books. We should have good books, too. You know, he believed and he wanted the best. And that's why he thought that only the vote would be able to do that. Yes, I knew he was involved in the civil rights movement. I saw the things that he did and the things that he believed in. He believed in what was right. He had integrity beyond measure. He really did. And as the years passed, you know, and I used to just, I wonder why such a young age. But when I matured and became older, I said, what else was there for him to do? I think truly the Lord had allowed him to establish everything and to do everything that he was supposed to do on this side. I really believe that. I think his destiny of what he was supposed to do in this world on this side, that he truly did that.
Y'all is amazing. I was looking, you said your father basically had a lot of courage, and I was looking at the fact that here was a man who was 5'4" tall and 150 pounds. he had the character and heart of a giant. I said, man, what
yes,
came with the power to stand like that? Because
yes.
I heard when he got shot, when I was reading some of the stuff online, was that some of the black folks saw, the same folks he tried to help empower,
Exactly.
Happened, but they didn't hide about it.
That's right. Exactly.
How do you feel about the community not coming behind your father like he did so many times for the community, rallying behind him?
I don't know. It's kind of mixed emotion because
mm-hmm.
for me, all I could see was the person that pulled the trigger. I couldn't see anything else. That was where my anger lied. With them, it was with the person that pulled the trigger. As for the people that he tried to help, maybe in my what I understood at the time
mm-hmm.
was because they were like almost one of us. If Daddy had two pieces of meat, you were supposed to share it with your neighbor. Mm-hmm. And that's what he tried to do. If he were trying to get ahead, he wanted to bring you along with him. You know, and to me, that is being a servant. That is thinking more of mankind than yourself.
Yeah, that is amazing. I just think, like, how do you feel that, where did it come from, his commitment to service and putting himself on the line for others? Where do you think it came from in the family?
My mom told me, years ago, you're asking me that, and I remember asking her that when they did the Civil Rights Memorial in Montgomery in 1989. I said, Mother, where did Daddy get this from? And she said, Ruby, he grew up hard. He always wanted to have things, and he worked hard. So she said that he told her, Daddy told her, you know, if the Lord blessed me with a good wife, I would do everything in my power to make sure that they didn't want for anything, that he would try to do what he could to help others. And you know, Daddy felt the same way about his church, about his pastor. It wasn't just his home and his community. It was the whole thing. When we finished our farming, you know what we used to do? We worked in our flower yard. He cared just as much about our flower yard. And we all love flowers. We all have beautiful flower yards. And that's what we did. It wasn't like, oh, you know, I'm just interested in farming. I'm not worried about a crop. No. When the farms were in the summer, and then, you know, the crops, you just waited for the harvest, for the crops to make, so you could harvest them. Well, we worked in our flowers. He took the boys to cut trees, came home, planted trees, planted rose bushes, rearranged the hedges. I'm telling you, he was just a phenomenal man. It was almost like he lived in a time that he shouldn't have been living in. It's true. It's amazing.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, he sounded like a spectacular man. He was just 42 when he died, correct?
Daddy was born, we were talking about that today, and we were looking at some other. I know Daddy was 5 years older than Mother.
Mm-hmm.
I know Mother was born in 1917. So when Daddy died, Mother was, what, 44? So Daddy had to be 49 or 50.
Okay. And what was the immediate aftermath? Did y'all end up moving on? What happened afterwards?
No. We what happened? We lived a life of fear. I did, because we felt like there was no protection around us. You know, Daddy kept us from all of that. I mean, even he knew the dangers in Liberty. Daddy wouldn't let us go to Liberty. We shopped in Kentwood. He didn't expose us to those things. No, he told us about them, but he didn't expose you and subject you to them. If we went to see, even if we visited my mother's sister, who lived in Liberty on the outskirts of 24, he would go to Louisiana and come up into Mississippi.
Mm.
He would not drive through Mississippi. And now you can ask me, well, why did he go to the cotton? Because he had cotton, and there was no other place to take his cotton.
Oh, wow. That's incredible. So, man, when did the fear ever subside with you all? I mean, after September 25th, 1961? I mean, when did the fear subside? Did it ever subside?
Did what happen?
Did the fear ever subside? Did it ever go away, the fear?
I guess with time, I think time has a way of taking the fear away. Were we fearful? Yes, because here we were, a mom and my second oldest sister was back home at the time, and mm-hmm. eight children. You live on a rural road who there's almost like one way in and one way out. You were too afraid to go places at night, and you wonder, okay, the same thing is going to happen to me. We knew the Klans were busy in the area. We knew right. that. One night we came home from revival, and mother wasn't feeling well. So my oldest brother, Roy, drove us to church that night because it was revival meeting. And after church, that's when mother said, you all come right home. So after the services were dismissed, we just kind of sat around and chit-chatted, talked a little bit. So Roy said, we better go home. As we were coming the loop, we saw this smoke just billowing right in our mailbox. And we saw the car pull off ahead of us. And when we pulled in, that's when we saw the cross that was burning in our mailbox. And Roy said, oh, my God, if we had come a little bit early, you know, they would have been here. And it was like, you know, the Lord had saved us from danger. But we were scared because my mother was in the house. But they probably didn't know because she wasn't feeling well. And I remember us just going in the house that night, I don't know, just being scared, just huddled together in one room, just out of fear.
Wow, that's amazing. What happened to the representative of Hearst? What, anything ever happened to him?
No. And you know the sad part about it, we would see him pass. You know, you go to the grocery store, you would see him. You would go to church on Sundays. He passed the church. You could pass him on the highway, and it was like there was no way around him. He lived in a community where we live. But you know, time has a way of I don't know, healing, coping with evil, and we saw a man that we lived in a community, but we saw a man who just lived by deteriorating. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying, but you like you live, but you're non-existent.
So he's just basically disappearing, like he become irrelevant over time. I mean,
that's right, exactly.
Wow. So did he become sick? Did he ever try to make amends with the family, or did he ever reach out to you all?
No, he did. And the funny thing, my mom and my mother told me. She said, Mr. Yates sent for me. I said, what? She said, he sent. I said, sent for you? She said, yes. I said, mother, you didn't go. I think at that time I was traveling in Europe because my husband was military. Mm-hmm. I said, mother. She said, no. I just told the person telling I love him. And I said, really? She said, yes. And she said, I didn't have anything to say to him. I said, mother, I would have gone. I said, I wish I had known. She said, you would have gone? I said, yes. Because I have always wanted to ask him, what made you follow my father to liberty on that dirt highway? And what made you hate him so much that you could just pull a trigger and kill him and leave him, his widow, and eight children at home? What drove you to that? What was it? And I said, if that's what I would have asked him. But I heard, my mother said that when his funeral was, that he had asked, you know, to not even take him in the church building. I said, why? No. But mother didn't teach us to hate. But like I told him today, I think I've garnered enough all on my own. I really did. Because here we were brought up with a dad who was persevering, wanted to ensure that we got a good education, was mm-hmm. going to take care of my mom. You know, things that we didn't have to worry about, where we had to just really learn how to be mother. Daddy managed our household, you know. He was the one that had hardly any education, but my mom taught my father how to write his name. But he was a good manager. He managed money. He could manage the farm. He was an excellent provider. He just had the Lord blessed him with those gifts, and he used them for the good of his family and others. And then now here we are. We were too small. What were we going to manage? Who was going to listen to us? My brothers were too young, and mother did not know how to do that. So, but she had to learn. And her learning, you know, even she said, I know I got beat out of a lot of things because I just didn't have the know-how that Herbert had. Mm-hmm. I didn't know how to deal with people in the banks and things like that. I did. Because she didn't have to. Daddy did that.
Mm. So how are y'all able to survive? I mean, your father was such a powerful figure in terms of his presence, and also, like, he knew how to manage a lot of things. He knew how to keep a lot of things away from you all in terms of trouble and worry. How was y'all able to get along without him then? I mean, how, financially and all the other things.
We had the dairy, we had the farm, and we had the dairy. And my mother wanted to make sure that we held on to the dairy, and we held on to the farm, and at all costs, we held on to the property. And he always said, the land would take care of you. So we used the land.
Mm.
And that's how we were able to take care. We had, we grew our vegetables. We had, you know, we grew, you know, our beef, we had pork. It's the same thing. So that's how we were able to survive. You know, and he did leave mother and dad. When he died, the property was paid for.
Wow, that's a blessing. Wow, that's amazing. He really had a...
Exactly.
Yeah, wow, he really could.
Right.
He had his priorities in order.
Go ahead. No, he really did. He did not lose focus. His priorities were in order. And, you know, I look back over that, and I would just like to say, wow, Dad, you know. And I said, he really had it together. He really did. He truly did.
What about you got one witness who saw what happened to your father, and who recanted his testimony, his original testimony, Lewis Allen? Did he ever come? You remember him? Did he ever come around afterwards?
I did not know Mr. Allen. I knew of Mr. Allen. I knew of the events that what happened. Mm-hmm. I knew that. Where all this air coming from? I knew that, but I never knew him. But you know what? I always wondered. Mm-hmm. I met his son at some of the events. I always wondered. I said, wow, they could have blamed us for their father's death. They could have easily said, if our dad had been trying to right or wrong, he could have been with us. So Lewis Allen is just, you're talking about, this may not be a good expression, but I'm going to use it like tied at the hip.
Mm-hmm.
I always think of them, and I always think of them in that manner. Bubba was able to stay in Mississippi and rear her children and live off. The Allens weren't able to do that because their dad was a logger. So if he couldn't bring the logs in, his business wasn't self-sufficient like dad's was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, dad could still go out and grow potatoes, peanuts, kinds of whatever, you know, to take for us to have something to eat. He could do those things. He wasn't so much dependent on the private sector to make a living, to provide an income for him.
Mm. So that means like it's a tale of two. I mean, it's a tale of one side of the coin. Your father, he had a lot of stuff prioritized in order. He was an astute business person, but you're applying to those. The Allen family had to really suffer more so than y'all did in terms of financially.
Yes.
Either state.
Yeah, and I think they relocated to Baton Rouge. It also could have been because his son, Mr. Allen's son, were a little bit older than my brother. They were grown. Mm-hmm. They could have seen his son as more of a threat than my brothers. My brothers were very young. You know, they were actually children, and his sons were older. And I think that I remember reading that there had been a threat against one of Mr. Allen's son's lives.
Mm-hmm.
So they just lived. And my brothers, you know, they were too young to even think about what were we going to do? Who were we going to make a threat against?
Right. So I bet y'all was a lot of ways very blessed then that we able to not have that played out if they were considered threats.
That is true.
I'd ask you too. I mean, what are you seeking anything from the state of Mississippi? Anything from the county, Amity County, or any institution in the state of Mississippi for restitution, restorative justice?
Have we? You said have we?
Yeah, have you all? Yes, yes, ma'am.
Have we tried? No. Do we want to?
Yes. Yeah, I would ask that too. Yeah, two questions.
I've asked myself this question, and I've not given myself an answer yet. But what I would like, and what I would like for people to know who my father is,
mm-hmm.
my father was, and the things that he stood for and believed in, that we as a people are profiting and rise on a lot of those grassroots people in the 60s.
Right.
That's what I would like for people to know. Justice for my father. I think my father got a lot of his justice today with that marker and that cotton gin.
Mm-hmm.
I think that cotton gin being a national historical mark, I see those things as being a justice for him. As for saying E.H. Hirsch was guilty, he never said he didn't kill my father.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he has long since been dead anyway. So to me, in some sense, for me,
mm-hmm.
I think justice has been served in that respect. I really believe that.
Yeah, man, that's a great answer, I believe, in terms of, I mean, nobody can really argue with that. How do you feel about the fact that the state of Mississippi has no museum dedicated to the memory of people like your father, Herbert Lee? They have
no
in the state of Mississippi.
No, they don't. They really don't. I don't even know. When I think of the state of Mississippi, I guess you can say I never really thought about the state of Mississippi doing anything instead. I always thought about liberty.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why. I just did. I thought about that little small portion of the map, that spot, that Liberty, Mississippi, not the state as a whole. So that is difficult for me to answer. I don't know how I feel about Mississippi not recognizing deity or not doing any restitution of anything. I don't know.
I mean, what about his death certificate? I mean, the way he
I'm
died.
Sorry.
I mean, like the way they say he died, the official record. I mean, like how they officially say he died. They act like that E.H. Hirsch was...
Yes, those things I would like to see corrected, yes. I really would. I would like to see those things corrected.
I'm thinking like one of the most, like the Mississippi State Legislature, and I was in Mound Bayou on Labor Day weekend, and they named a portion of Old Highway 61 in honor of Dr. T.M. Howard, civil rights hero from the 50s and 60s up in Mound Bayou. and named a portion of old Highway 61 in his honor. But it's like it was a push by the Mississippi State Legislature to get that done. And to me, it's like the make commands for one of their own, E.H. Hurst, who was a Mississippi State Legislator. It's like they would have been, what, anybody present from the Mississippi State Legislature today to honor the historical marker and the family?
Yes, there were. And I would have to look back at the program, which I don't have in front of me, but they were.
Okay.
They were.
It's like, so I'm just saying, like, he always try to say, well, that was a long time ago. I said, that wasn't long. It's not even 50 years yet. That wasn't that long ago when that happened. And, you know, one of their own did that. We talk about, you know, the abuses now of the government in terms of the local, state, and national. You had the Mississippi Sovereignty Commission, which did a lot of abuse to civil rights activists back then. I mean, you had people that were setting up people to get killed, I mean, from the community, informants and stuff like that. A lot of damage was done to undermine a people's struggle, a people's movement, which was about practice things like your father stood for. And to me, Mississippi State has not done enough up to this current day to honor that sacrifice that so many people have given up their lives or their time and their resources to try to help Mississippi actually become a better place to live.
But I do not recall his name. I'm sorry. I don't.
But somebody did give a proclamation.
My notes are packed.
Somebody did present a proclamation on behalf of the Mississippi State Legislature.
The proclamation was done by, there was a proclamation from the Mississippi House of Representatives.
Okay.
And then from Macomb, there was also one. The mayor, Zachary Patterson.
Okay. I asked all this stuff why it's important, because I know that Governor Haley Barbour want to do a big ado next year for the Freedom Rides to commemorate the
Freedom. Oh, you know who told me about that? John Gibson was there.
Okay,
he shared that information with me.
I just think it's rather odd, though, considering that there's no museum to honor the memories of the people who sacrificed so much during the struggle.
Wasn't he using some of the participants in the struggle, their name, in order to promote what he was doing, like from the left side? But he was using some of the members who had worked in the struggle, had participated in the struggle, not members, participants in the struggle. He was using their names almost like to promote his agenda for people that he wanted to attend.
Exactly. I mean, I just think it's rather odd because, I mean, they don't want to talk about the past, but they want to make a profit off the past.
Yes.
But they don't want to acknowledge the pain. But they want
that's
to profit
right.
from it. And that's why
exactly.
I'm
exactly. That's
not right.
right. And mm-hmm. that's right. And sometimes, and someone said that today, you know, the devil's in the closet. If you want to move on, you got to get the devil, you got to let the devil out of the closet.
That's right. That's exactly right. And that's why I asked you that was enough. I mean, Governor Haley Barbour should acknowledge what happened. And it will happen to your father almost 50 years ago. It will be 50 years ago next year in September. But
oh, yes. I understand. I understand what you're saying. I really, really understand. And I agree.
Have anybody from any cold case organizations approached you all, like from Syracuse University or from Northeastern?
No. There was someone from 60 Minutes called me on the 18th.
Oh, wow.
But I did not, at that time, I was preparing for a lesson for our women's group at church. And I had like 30 minutes prior to leaving. And my focus was there. And I said to her, I just could not talk. So we set up a time for that Saturday, but she didn't call me back. And I did put in a call to her later on in the week of, you know, the following week, but I did not hear from her again. So I've not had any other contact information from anyone else. Someone else's contact.
Oh, yeah. I just think that it's like they're just looking for, like, it seems like a lot of times the people that they look at for a flavor of the moment, or they trying to make something, then they don't want to follow up. And that's my disappointment. A lot of different people and institutions that we don't follow up for justice, to see things through. It's like this has been a struggle from you all ever since September 25th, 61, to try to get some acknowledgement of what happened to your father. That's
yes, that,
me.
That is right. And you know, it's funny. I was telling my daughter, I told Carrie, I really hate I missed the lady with 60 Minutes, but where were you all these other years ago? You know,
right.
And my really feeling that I had something that was a priority then, and
mm-hmm.
I love my dad, and I want my father's name out there, but I to this day, I still feel that I did the right thing. I was not going to drop that and run over here. Daddy
right.
would not have wanted me to do that because my word was given to the lady and to the Lord and what I was supposed to do. And I was not going to drop that for something for 6 minutes.
Well, you know, when you said that, even before you said that, I thought about your father's commitment to the community, to his family, to his church, and to anybody he cared about. So you really are your father's daughter then, in terms of his commitment and service. But I applaud you for that. Now, it's really refreshing to know that some of the things he instilled in you in your 9 years of living with him carry on throughout your whole life. And you,
that's
and
right.
you spread that, and that's good. It means he didn't die in vain at all. And but man, there was nothing that told me about Mississippi is the fact that a lot of this history is not in the textbooks. A lot of black kids not know about Herbert Lee or
that
about the civil rights
right.
movement, and
that
that's very
right.
disturbing to me to know that you know people ain't really talking about it or reading about it. Or
that's
learning about
true,
it.
But sometimes I think some of that also rests with us and
mm-hmm.
what we have done, didn't do, could have done. I followed whatever I could do, wherever I could put myself. I did that, and I really, really shared a lot with Carrie. The people that I came in contact with, I tried to introduce them to her. I never forget one year, I think I was a freshman. No, I was a sophomore at Jackson State. And at that time, they were talking about introducing this black history book
mm-hmm.
into the mainstream. And I remember going to Dansby Hall to just hear what they had to say. And as I sat in on the lecture about the history book, and I was thumbing through there, and I said, "There, your dad's name is in this book." And sure enough, there it was. And other things that I've gone to, and I looked and I said, "So many have prospered from daddy's death." I remember. Mm-hmm. reading Parting the Waters by Branch, who was from Maryland, years
mm-hmm.
ago. And I said, they really prospered, but what have I done? Have I really done, Dad, what you wanted me to do? So sometimes in your focus on resentment and hate, you can't move and do those things.
Right.
So while I understand what you're saying, but I do ask myself, but what have we done? What have we done?
Yeah, I know you said that. No, go ahead, I'm sorry.
For me, I'm telling you, Black History Program, I couldn't even participate in a Black History Program without Google. And so, no, if someone else didn't happen to mention my dad, no
mm-hmm.
one do. And I remember when we first moved to the Virginia area, a relative of my husband, they knew about my father, and they introduced, you know, what had happened to him. And it was like people were just shocked. They just couldn't believe it.
Mm.
But, you know, and I said to them, Megger Evers, we knew him. We met him at my father's funeral. He came by our home and visited with us after Dad was killed. But he was the same way until Mary Lee really fought to bring the man to justice that killed him, and they made that movie. That's how they got his name out there. But he was a little unknown too, but he was really a great person. But before that, he was unknown also.
Mm.
But there are a lot of grassroots that really, really work behind the scenes that enable us to do what we do today. You know, and I often wonder how many, I should have asked that question today, how many, but don't put your hand up, how many went to the polls to vote?
Mm.
in the November 6th election? How many of you are encouraging your children to vote, to go and register to vote? When they turn 18, are you saying you need to vote? How many are we saying to, especially our black males, you know, you need to, you don't need to be in jail. You don't need to be doing these things because you lose your right to vote.
Right.
And once that's gone, it's gone. So you don't how do you get that back? So you're losing a voice. So it's almost like if they're no longer waiting in the bushes. Well, honestly, they don't have to.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have to wait in the bushes with the guns anymore. The same thing that daddy fought for and died for. We just give it away freely.
Mm.
We don't understand the power of the vote. We don't understand what it really means to go and register. How important it is. We don't teach that. And what I'm saying is, it doesn't have to be taught in school. It could be taught at home.
Yeah, you know, I keep on thinking about it. You said that, but I work with the school system in Memphis. I mean, a lot of these kids are so young having kids. I mean, a lot of them, like, they're 18 or 19, they got, like, five-year-olds. And I look how they act in the classroom, and you just can't make up for great parenting or good parenting. There's no substitute for that, but if they don't have any, like, examples of that in the home and the environment where they come from,
yeah.
I just really feel sorry for us as people because they don't know about Herbert Lee or Mandela Evans. They don't know about all the people that came before.
And
the value of what, you know, like you just said, all this stuff is very important, we just said, but, I mean, if you come from an environment that don't espouse these type of principles and character, y'all were very blessed to have the type of mom and father that y'all had, you know.
Yes.
Your father might have limited learning, but he never limited himself. He never limited his world outlook. You know,
that's
not
true.
How you find is how you finish that really counts. So I just think it is very important what you said, and a lot of this blame does lay at our feet in terms of not picking up the torch or taking it to the next plateau. There's so many things we could have done, but yeah, I mean, I just look at the fact that even our definition of success is so narrow-minded when you think about it. Just get a good job, you know.
That's right.
Money.
That's right.
Don't rock the
That's
boat.
That's right.
No, don't point out wrongs.
That's
right. You want to keep your job.
That's right.
You want to keep your station.
Exactly.
They told a lot of people do your dare time. They'll shut up.
That's right.
If you want to keep your place in line.
That's right. That is right. And that was not daddy. So it goes back to the question, you know, who are you serving? Who are you providing for? What contribution are you making? To right some of these social ills that we have. What are we doing?
Now, what is the way
that,
go ahead. Yes, ma'am.
We used that back when I came up in my generation, we used the church, we used the school system,
mm-hmm.
we used the means at our disposal. Well, what has happened? You know, it's difficult to use that in the school system anymore.
Mm-hmm.
The churches now are about they think they arrive because they teach and believe
right.
in a lot of prosperity.
Mm-hmm.
So. It's bad to say, but it's almost like the white man says, "Ooh, okay, I got you now. You know,
mm-hmm.
I really got you. I gave you all this stuff you wanted. So, look what it has done to you. It served no greater good, and it served no greater good, not because it wasn't good, but because of what we did, what we did do with it."
Right. That's probably exactly right on that. I just like, and I was like, what are y'all doing as far as the family concerned? I know y'all doing like, you know, going to the events and whatnot to uphold his memory. Like, what are y'all doing until the generations from now to know that this man that Herbert Lee existed to come on down and did some extraordinary things against some extraordinary odds? Like, how y'all got books in plan or documentaries or what's in plan for the family in terms of keeping Herbert Lee's life?
You asked me this, and other than trying to other than trying to pass it on to the grandchildren, not anything. What have I thought that I've honestly thought about, okay, Ruby, what can you do? And I had said a long, long time ago, years ago, and I remember telling a friend of mine in college, and he laughed. I said, one of these days, I'm going to pin Daddy's history to a book. And he said, really? I said, yes, I am. And he said, what are you going to say? He said, it's just so much you can say about the civil rights movement. I said, Daddy wasn't about just the civil rights movement. I said, there's a whole herd of me out there that people don't even have a clue about who this man was.
It'd be a very important book to pen. I definitely agree with that.
So that's one of the things that I've really thought about a lot of it in the past year. That, you know, some of the things that I've just kind of jotted down, even so much as different words that I would like to use in a title, but we shall see.
I mean, just talking to you about this stuff, I mean, like I said, my job, I have to amplify these type of stories, these unsung heroes and sheroes that are in our community. It's kind of like the Bible. When you look at the Bible, a lot of the greatest heroes or sheroes in the Bible were very flawed people that were just normal people. They had everyday problems. I mean,
that is right.